morning, everyone. Welcome to Calvary Chapel Somerville. We invite you to stand with us for praise and worship this morning.
Great is your faithfulness, O God. You wrestle with the sinner's heart. You lead us by still waters into mercy, and nothing can keep us apart. So remember your people, remember your children, remember your promise, O God. Your grace is enough. Your grace is enough for me. Great is your love and justice, God. You use the weak to lead the strong. You lead us in the song of your salvation, and all your people sing along. So remember your people, remember your children, remember your promise, O God. Your grace is enough for me. Your grace is enough. Your grace is enough. Your grace is enough for me. So remember your people. Remember your children. Remember your promise, O God. Your grace is enough. Your grace is enough. Your grace is enough for me. Your grace.
against me shall remain. I will rejoice, I will declare, God is my victory and He is here. This is my prayer in the battle, when triumph is still on its way. I am a conqueror and co-heir with Christ, so firm on His promise I'll stand.
Father God, we praise You this morning, God. We are co-heirs and conquerors in Christ Jesus. Father, we thank You, Lord, as children of God who stand firm on the promises of Your word, God, in Your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, we are not overcome. We thank You for Your provision for us, God. Awaken us this morning to Your truth. Awaken us this morning to who You are. Your power. Fill us this morning, God, with Your Holy Spirit. Father, I pray that our hearts and our minds would be Yours, God, this morning. We love You and we praise You. In Jesus' name.
Empty-handed, but not forsaken. take our weakness. You set your treasure in jars of clay. So take this heart, Lord, I'll be your vessel, the world to see.
To Calvary,
which Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah stood, and all alone. Oh, praise the name of the Lord.
Blazing sun shall pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints, my gaze transfixed on Jesus' face. Oh, we praise you, Lord, in this place today. You are worthy of our praise. Thank you, Jesus. We raise our hallelujah to you this morning, God. May our eyes be transfixed on you this morning, Lord. You are greater. You are bigger. We love you, God. You are worthy this morning. Let's lift our voices. He is worthy this morning. Praise the name.
Oh, praise the name of the Lord.
Oh, We praise you this morning. Father God, we thank you, Lord. We thank you for what you have done. There is no greater love. You laid down your life for your children, for your people, Father God. Lord, we thank you. We praise you. We give you honor. God, I pray, Lord, that you would open our eyes this morning, God, if we have hardened our hearts in any way, God, that you alone would soften them, that you would turn our eyes, God, towards you. Father, that we would see you. God, open our eyes this morning to your great love displayed on the cross. Thank you, Father, for a hope that you have given us. You've given us eternity. Lord, we will praise you for all eternity. God, if we don't understand what that means, Lord, I pray that you would enlighten us, enlighten your people, your children, God. Lord, this is not all there is. You didn't send your son for us just to live in the here and the now, but God, that our eyes would be transfixed on the hope of Jesus and where we're going. So Father, we love you and we praise you and we ask God that you would do a mighty move in this place today and in our lives, that we might not leave here the same way we walked in. We love you so much and we praise you. Thank you for what you've done. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. That's how you change
the world. Thank you for listening to Changing the World with Pastor Vic Carroll from Calvary Somerville. It is our hope that this message will help you grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, with today's message, here's Pastor Vic.
Let's pray.
Father, your righteous judgments are true and they do endure forever and ever. The entirety of your word is true. Help us, Lord, to desire your word, that we may hang on every syllable, every jot and tittle that you speak to us this morning, that we may be moved and shaken out of our seats, Lord, because of your Holy Spirit and your desire for greater intimacy with your people. Would you speak to us through your word today, God? Would you anoint your word? Would you bless our hearts that we might hear your word? Anoint this place. Fill us with your presence. Bless us, God. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. If you would, let's turn in our Bibles to the book of 2 Corinthians. And we are in chapter 12 as we continue our journey through God's word from Genesis to Revelation. 2 Corinthians chapter 12. You remember last time that there were these self-appointed apostles that were in the church in Corinth who were continuing to challenge Paul in regards to his spiritual authority and his authority as an apostle. And these, Paul called them false apostles because they were boasters. They liked to brag about their accomplishments, and they liked to brag about their knowledge and their abilities as speakers and orators. But what they were doing, as Paul pointed out, is they were bragging about their credentials as apostles. They were confirming the fact that they were apostles. They're just not apostles of God. They're apostles of Satan, as Paul said. Because a true apostle of God would never boast in his accomplishments or the accomplishments of his ministry, because he wouldn't have any. All of our accomplishments in ministry are of God and by his grace. And so Paul says, if I'm going to boast, if I'm going to be like you guys, if I'm going to boast in anything, I'm going to boast in my sufferings and my infirmities. That's what shaped Paul into who he was as a minister and, as Jason said, an ambassador of God. And then, as Paul said, he's going to boast in his infirmities. That's exactly what he did. The whole last chapter was kind of dedicated to, you know, this whole list of what you and I would think are inhumane things that Paul had to endure for the sake of the gospel and for the sake of the church. He talked about all the stripes on his body, which were, you know, just scars from the beatings that he had taken. Too many scars to even count, he said. Stonings, muggings, shipwrecks, imprisonments, going hungry, going without sleep, cold, naked. Those are the things that Paul presented that, you know, that were the greatest evidence and you know, the credentials of a true apostle. Because no one would endure what Paul had to endure, not for money, not for power, not for fame. No one would walk or live the life that Paul had been called to unless he had been called by God. And now Paul here in chapter 12, as we move on, he's going to continue. He's going to lay out even more compelling evidence as it relates to him being called by God. And he's going to talk about a particular vision that God had given him. He says, verse 1, as he communicated a couple of times last week, it is doubtless not profitable for me to boast. I don't want to talk about myself. It does no one any good to talk about myself. I shouldn't have to defend my ministry, he says. But he does it anyway. Why? Because he cared about what people thought of him? No. Because he cared about the message that God had given him. He cared about what the people thought, not of him, but what they thought of Jesus. And what comes with the rejection of the truth that Paul brought to that church in Corinth, what comes of you know, with a rejection of Paul's message is a rejection of the Jesus that Paul spoke of, the Jesus of the Bible. So he says, for your sakes, I will boast, but not in myself. I'm going to boast in what God has done. And then he says here, I will come to visions and revelations of the Lord. He's, you know, talking about particular dreams and visions that God had given him. And certainly one of the ways that God communicates to us is through dreams and visions. Most of you know my testimony here, and that the reason that there is a Calvary Chapel Somerville at all is mainly because of two very specific prophetic visions that God gave me just out of the clear blue sky. Prior to coming here and prior to planting this church or becoming a pastor, let me tell you, I had given about as much thought as planting a church and becoming a pastor as I had becoming an astronaut or, you know, the president of China or whatever. But what I was doing is I was seeking the Lord. I was seeking the Lord. I was seeking greater intimacy with God in my life. And it was during that time when God gave me these two visions, one shortly before we moved here and then one about 2 weeks after we moved here. And you know, I think I told you before, I don't want to make it sound like that I'm, you know, any different than anybody else or that I'm Mr. Super Christian or whatever. You know, dreams and visions, I hear people talking about that kind of stuff, and I'm like, yeah, that stuff never happens to me. And it never had happened to me. I was saved at 19 years old, you know, been walking with the Lord for 30 years, and this was the first time the Lord had ever spoken to me through a dream. But he did. And then God made it very clear what he brought, you know, my family here to do, and even confirmed it with my wife. And most of you know the story. I won't go into it, but, you know, here we are. Now, before we go on, one thing I do want to stress, though, is that we have to be very cautious when it comes to dreams. I think a lot of people, a lot of Christians, make the mistake of thinking that every dream has some sort of spiritual meaning or significance, when most of the time they're just a result of human imagination, or, you know, maybe it's just some kind of reaction to whatever you had for dinner last night, you know. But you know, we need to be careful not to misapply or give spiritual significance or, you know, some, you know, significance to some meaningless dream. There's two things we need to understand based on Scripture, based on the Word. One, obviously, any dream or vision that is contrary to the Word of God is not of God. Now, I've had people say to me, like, God told me that this man was going to be my husband. And I'm like, that man's got a wife already. I don't think God told you that, or God showed me in a dream, how I was going to be married to, no, he didn't. That's not from God. God will never contradict his word, okay, in any communication with you. The second thing is we have a lot of examples in the Bible of God giving specific directions to an individual person through dreams and visions, and almost every time he does it through that very person. The dream, the direction or whatever, God speaks the direction through the dream to that very person. So if someone comes to you and says, hey, God showed me in a dream last night that you're gonna marry this guy, or God showed me in a dream that you were gonna become this or that, I would be very cautious in how you receive that. Because if God wanted to reveal something prophetic about you, in a direction in your own life, he's probably going to reveal that to you personally and not someone else. Not to say that he can't. Now, we don't put God in a box, but just that, he usually doesn't do it that way. So just be cautious in how you receive prophetic dreams from other people about your own life. People, as a pastor, they want occasionally someone will come up and say, I had a, had a dream about, you and you're going to do this and you're going to become that and the church is going to become this. And I just say, okay, well, thank you. I take that into consideration and I appreciate it. And that's all you can do, and then you just sit back and you just wait. And if it comes to fruition, then it was of the Lord. The problem is if it doesn't come to fruition, you don't sit back and go, God, what's going on? You said this, and God's like, no, I didn't. So, just be obvious or be cautious. And, again, we do find in Scripture, particularly here with the Apostle Paul, God gave Paul many, many dreams and visions throughout his ministry, and some were visions of just individual encouragement. Other times, it was visions pertaining to direction. Certainly, God revealed many revelations of truth. But specifically here, as we're getting into chapter 12 here, Paul's going to talk about this specific vision or, whether it's a vision or dream or whatever, he doesn't know. But it's a vision that God gave to Paul in particular that he's going to talk about here. And he says in verse 2, I know a man in Christ. And again, because Paul doesn't want to come across as if he were bragging. So he's going to refer to himself here in the third person, just to make sure and avoid any of that. I know a man in Christ who, notice, 14 years ago, so for 14 years, Paul's about to reveal something that he has kept silent, something big, like stupendous. He's kept silent for 14 years about this particular vision. But he describes it. He says, whether in the body, I do not know, or whether out of the body, I do not know, God knows. And as we're going to see, the vision is Paul was taken up into heaven. And he was given this elaborate tour of what's awaiting us in paradise. And he says, I don't know if I was there physically. I don't know if I was there, bodily, or if it was just God taking me there, in a dream. I don't know if I had died and gone to heaven or not. Only God knows. He says, but such a man was caught up to the third heaven. Now, what is the third heaven? Does that mean heaven has all these different layers? No, that's not what he's talking about. It's not suggesting that. What Paul means by third heaven, the terminology that he's using here in the original language, is one where you see, the earth's atmosphere, like our inner atmosphere. What is it, like something like 100 miles out there, whatever, and it's got the ozone layer and all this stuff. That's the first heaven. Then beyond that, you have the moon and the stars and the sun, and the cosmos, the universe. That's the second heaven. The third heaven is what Paul was raised up to see. And, you know, it's just this vision of paradise, the presence of God, the throne of the divine. And so Paul gets this vision of heaven. It's the same vision that God gave to the prophet Isaiah, the same vision that God gave to John over in Revelation chapter 4, where, you know, these men are given just this tiny glimpse of heaven. And, you know, I don't know about you, but I've often thought how cool it would be. And I've prayed for this. I prayed for it lots of times as I'm going to bed at night and I'm praying. I pray, God, would you let me dream about heaven tonight? Would you let me dream about what we have, you know, what you have in store for us? I mean, I just want a little peek, just a little glimpse. He hasn't answered that prayer yet, by the way, but I keep praying for it. How cool would it be just to be given, you know, just kind of raise up the curtain and just get a little look. But he did that for Paul. And it says here, I know such a man, verse 3, whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows how he was caught up into paradise and heard, Paul says, inexpressible words. Now, it's speculated, and it could be true, that this happened maybe. Remember, Paul was basically stoned to death outside the city of Lystra, and he was left there for dead. The people that stoned him believed he was dead, and he might have been dead. And this might be the time where he actually died, was taken up into heaven, and then God said, "You know what? I'm not done with your ministry on earth," and then sent him back. You know, it's speculation. You know, whether he was there, you know, in a dream or bodily or you know, spiritually, whatever, we don't know. He says only God knows. But I think it's interesting that here's a guy who was given, you know, this glimpse of heaven, yet he doesn't relate anything to us here in 2 Corinthians chapter 12. He doesn't relate anything about what he saw, only what he heard. But even what he heard was beyond anything that he can describe or elaborate on using human language. He heard inexpressible words, he says, meaning what he heard was beyond anything that he had the ability to characterize with limited human vocabulary. In fact, he says here, I heard words which is not lawful for a man to utter. So there are no words. There's no form of human communication, Paul says, where I can describe heaven to you in a way that would do it justice. And so it would be a travesty. It even would be unlawful, he says, for me to try to communicate just what I heard. Forget about what I saw, just what I heard. It would be unlawful for me to try to communicate that to you. So he doesn't, which is probably why God has never answered my prayer, and he's never given me, you know, a dream or a vision of what heaven looks like, because I guarantee you, I would try to describe it. I mean, I'd be like, first person I could find, I'm like, you're not going to believe what I saw and what I heard. Well, what'd you see in here? Like, well, let me try, put it into words. And then, you know, I'd write a book about it, but my words would fall infinitely short of doing it justice. And so, you know, no matter who I'm talking to, I would grossly lower the bar. I would lower their expectations of what heaven's going to be like, because there are no words, no matter how elaborate and beautiful and extraordinary, no matter how stupendous of a picture I might be able to paint with my words, my description would be grossly inferior to reality. That, you know, and again, for me to do it, Paul says, you know, you'd be committing a crime. It'd be like illegal for you to even try to put that in words. And what I find interesting about this is Paul in the last chapter and how this kind of relates, you know, one opposite to another. Paul in the last chapter, he laid out all of the human sufferings in life, basically. Everything that this world and the enemy can dish out, Paul says, I experienced it. But then we equate what he says here about heaven, about the reward, and you look at one extreme to the other, and then you have the same writer of 2 Corinthians chapter 11 and 2 Corinthians chapter 12 is also the same writer of Romans chapter 8, verse 8, 18, where you find the suffering of this life, all that life can dish out. And then you see the comparison of heaven. You see the comparison of the reward. And Romans 8, 18, he says, "For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be what? To be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us." I could compare those two. I can compare the sufferings on one side and the reward, what's waiting us in heaven. But not only, they don't make a scale to compare those two things. They're just, it would be like trying to, take a tomato and see how much it weighs against a Mack truck. You gotta use two different scales for those. So, but that's how much the reward of heaven, how far it outweighs, the suffering and the infirmities of this life that we have to endure here. Paul says, "I've seen sufferings. I've seen the reward, though." And in verse 5, "Of such a one I will boast, yet of myself I will not boast except in my infirmities." In other words, these self-appointed apostles, these false apostles that you have in your church there in Corinth, Paul's like, I doubt that any of them have ever been given a tour of heaven like I have. But as we see, they're the ones who are bragging. They're the ones who are boasting of their ministry. And then you got Paul here who had this magnificent thing happen in his life, and he's kept it silent for 14 years out of fear of, people thinking, well, if he's having visions and dreams like this, then he's just this super apostle and he's reached a level of spirituality that I can never reach. And let me worship Paul. And we see that, a lot with the Catholic Church, don't we? Where you're given these apostles, sort of worship and the sort of respect that only God deserves. Verse 6, "For though I might desire to boast, I will not be a fool, for I will speak the truth, but I refrain lest anyone should think of me above what he sees me to be or hears from me." Again, Paul's not trying to promote himself. He's promoting the gospel message. He's promoting a crucified and resurrected Jesus. And he doesn't want any sort of thing that he does in his life to distract people from the truth of the gospel and the message that God has put on his heart to bring to the lost world. He says, verse 7, "Lest I should be exalted above measure by the abundance of the revelations." So Paul didn't want to be seen as great. We have this, in our flesh, all of us, we want to be great, don't we? We want people to look at us and say, there's that guy's, he's great. That's not what Paul wanted. Unlike these false apostles, he wanted God to receive all the glory and the honor. He wanted God to be recognized, as greatness, not himself. And now, a second piece of evidence that Paul gives here, that he lays out in this chapter as another confirmation that he was called by God. He says here, interestingly enough, he says, "A thorn in the flesh was given to me," and then he says, "a messenger of Satan to buffet me." So God gave him this thorn in the flesh, and then he tells us why, a messenger of Satan to buffet me. He didn't tell us why, he tells us, the source behind it. So God allows Satan to come and to buffet me, to chastise me, to just do his thing. He allows Satan to just, give me the old 1-2. And you look at it, you go, why? Why would God allow Satan to afflict any one of his children, let alone a faithful servant like the Apostle Paul? And now Paul gives us the answer. He says, here's why he does it: "Lest I be exalted above measure." And you think about it. I can tell you, as a pastor, what you have to guard against. I was going to say, I was reading this book. Must not have been too much of an impression, because I can't remember the title of it. But anyway, the greatest danger in anyone who is being used by God in ministry, as God is doing great and mighty things through you, as others witness that and they look at this, the power of God and what God's doing in your life, human tendency is for other people to come along and exalt you and to put you up on this pedestal and just start thinking of you as this super Christian with superhuman abilities. And before you know it, if you're not careful, you start to believe it yourself and you become filled with pride. And then what, you know, a ministry that God had started and that God had launched and that God was doing wondrous things in and through, all of a sudden it becomes all about you and very little about God. And so what God does to protect his servants from becoming prideful, we all want God's blessings, but what God has to do is he has to couple blessings with afflictions in order to guard us against pride. He gave Paul a thorn in the flesh to protect him from pride. And even Paul, as we're going to see, whatever this thorn in the flesh is, he wanted rid of it. But even he recognized that this particular thorn, whatever it was and for however long it was supposed to be there, he recognized that it was a gift from God. As he says here, it was given to me. And when you think of thorns, as Paul relates here, this thorn in the flesh, now obviously it's speaking of some sort of affliction or some sort of infirmity. And when you think of thorns, maybe you have a rose garden. Maybe you like to do that kind of stuff. But you don't have to be a gardener to know that thorns are irritating. But the word that Paul used for thorns here in the original language, I want you to know that it's not the same term that's used for the kind of thorn that you would find in on the stem of a rose. The better translation for thorn here is like a tent stake. And not just, I'm talking like an 18-inch tent stake, where these Bedouins, they would travel and they would set up their tents and they would have to drive these huge stakes into the ground where, you're out in this open area. If you've ever been to Israel, and especially down in the Negev desert and area of, south of Jerusalem, it's windy and it's just open, So they'd have these big, huge tent stakes, and that's what Paul is referring to. So whatever this infirmity is, Paul wants us to know that it's more than a minor irritation, right? It's a major health issue. Now, we don't know exactly what it is. We know that Paul had a lot of infirmities. We know just from church history that, if he wasn't completely blind, he was mostly blind. We know that he had, these problems with, being a hunchback kind of, and had some problems with his, just the makeup of his body. But God doesn't give us a particular idea of what this thorn is. And I think this morning, the reason that he doesn't is because if God told us this particular thorn that Paul had in his flesh, if he said, it was like, I have this eye disease where it's very, very painful and I can't see, you and I would have the tendency to think that he's just talking about, eye disease when it comes to a thorn in the flesh. But not knowing what the thorn is, it gives you and I the ability, when we have particular infirmities, when we have particular afflictions, it gives us, it opens it up for us to be able to, just plug in what it is that Paul's talking about right here. It's just a whole general term, because all of us have thorns in the flesh from time to time. And as we're going to see, we all have thorns in the flesh that God chooses not to remove. But, this is not a minor irritation. It's a major health issue. It's a physical infirmity that Paul had to deal with every single day of his life. And it's an infirmity that he equates the pain to, whatever this is, he equates it to being impaled permanently by an 18-inch tent stake. Sounds painful. And Paul says, concerning this thing, this thorn in the flesh, I pleaded with the Lord three times that it might depart from me. And so Paul had an infirmity, and what did he do with it? He did the right thing. He took it to God. He probably had, you know, some elders come up and anoint him with oil, and you know, have probably had a bunch of people praying for him. He prayed. You know, Paul was the one who wrote Philippians 4:6. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be known to God. So he took his own advice. He prayed about it. He prayed for God to deliver him from it. He believed that God had the power and the ability to heal him. But what we need to recognize, another thing that God did with the Apostle Paul here this morning that I think he wants us to get, we need to recognize that God doesn't heal everybody of everything. The whole health and wealth, name it and claim it ideology, it's a mistake to put this burden on God's people of you know, this across-the-board judgment that God will heal anyone of anything if you just have enough faith. Certainly, faith is essential to healing, of course. But lack of faith is not the only reason that God chooses not to heal. And you never want the reason that God doesn't heal you to be because, A, you didn't ask. The Bible says you have not because you asked not. Or B, because you don't have enough faith. But understand, sometimes God chooses not to heal. And the reason is because you enduring the thorn, you enduring the burden, ultimately it serves a greater purpose than you being delivered from it. I don't think anyone would ever accuse the Apostle Paul. We already know that he prayed about it. No one would ever accuse the Apostle Paul of having a faith that was just too weak. You know, he asked to be delivered. He believed. Yet, as we're going to see, God didn't heal him. God didn't deliver him from this thorn. Paul said, three times I asked God to heal me. Now, this term three times, it doesn't mean a literal three times, like one, two, three, I prayed three times. It's a Hebrew phrase that means continually or without ceasing. So Paul says, I prayed to God over and over and over and over that he would heal and deliver me from this infirmity. And then he lets us know how God responded. And he, God, said to me, verse 9, my grace is sufficient for you, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. If you're writing in your Bibles, you might want to circle that word, my. You notice it's capital. So God says, my strength is made perfect in weakness. Those words, my, and those word, that, and that word, perfect. My strength is made perfect. Now God says, you be perfect just as I am perfect. We're striving for holiness, right? How do you achieve holiness? By learning that whatever infirmity I have, not only, you know, is God protecting me from others exalting me above measure, as Paul said, not only is God protecting me, you know, from pride in my own heart, but, you know, these infirmities, these thorns in the flesh, it gives me no choice but to surrender my power, all that I have, my own abilities. I surrender it all and solely rely on the power and the grace of God. Now, that is how God says, my power is manifested in your life. And it's you know, listen, nobody, it's not fun when we're walking through it. And there's nothing wrong with praying that God would deliver you from it. Nothing wrong with believing that he's going to deliver you from it. But just understand the sovereignty of God. And let the sovereignty of God reign in your life. Want the healer more than you want the healing. And watch God do a miraculous thing in your life. So God didn't remove the thorn from Paul. He might not remove your thorn. But what he will do is same as he did with Paul's. He will supply you with the power and the grace to endure it. And it's a power that, you know, and a grace that he says is sufficient. And whatever it is that you're having to endure, whatever God doesn't remove that thorn, know that it will ultimately somehow, beyond human logic, somehow it will ultimately work in your favor. And whatever this thorn is that God chose to help you to endure rather than deliver you from it. Another thing I can promise you is that will be the greater demonstration of God's love in your life. Now you think about this. Let me ask you one thing. When Jesus was going to that cross, ultimately, what did it turn out was the greater demonstration of love on God's part upon his son? Was it a greater demonstration of love if he had delivered Jesus from that cross? If he had removed, as Jesus asked, from him that cup, that wrath? Or is it a greater demonstration of love for God to have him endure it? And you know the answer to that. It's the reason we're sitting here this morning. The greatest demonstration of love in the history of the universe is when God sent his son Jesus to the cross. And thus it is with you and I sometimes. We might look at something in particular today. You might be walking through something, some affliction that God has not delivered you from. And you might think, man, it sure feels like God doesn't love me very much. But if you'll just draw what Paul drew, draw from his strength, draw from his grace, draw from his power, one day, I promise you, you're going to find that whatever it is that you're walking through, you're going to find it'll be because it was the greater demonstration of love on God's part in your life. As it was with Paul, the burden, the cross, the thorn, enduring it, served the greater purpose. So Paul says, therefore, most gladly, I will rather boast in my infirmities. Why? That the power of Christ might rest upon me. It's funny how the Christian life works, isn't it? God usually does things in ways that are opposite of the world. Whether it's a career or a hobby or whatever, as you become more and more skilled and educated and experienced at anything in life, you become more self-sufficient, don't you? And you become less dependent upon, the instruction manual. You become less dependent upon other people. You become more self-sufficient. But the more you grow in your Christian walk, it's just the opposite. The more you grow in your Christian walk, the closer you get to God, the less self-sufficient you are. And the more you depend on God, the more you depend on his strength and his grace. And knowing that, what is it in this life, more than anything else, what is it in this life that makes us more and more God-dependent? Thorns. Infirmities. And so, that's what Paul says. If we see that from God's perspective and heaven's perspective, that's what Paul says. These thorns, these infirmities, when it comes down to it, it's what I should be the most proud of. Because it's how the power of Christ is revealed in my life. It's how the power of Christ is being revealed in this world through the afflictions and through the thorns of God's people. And Paul goes as far as to say, verse 10, therefore I take pleasure in infirmities. Anybody? Raise a hand. I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in needs, in persecutions, in distresses. Why? For Christ's sake. And then I like this. For when I am weak, then I am strong. I am glad, Paul says, I am excited. I take pleasure in the fact that I have been compelled through sufferings to rely on the grace and the strength of God. When I am weak, I am strong. When I become so weak that I have no choice but to fully rely on God, that's when I am at my strongest capacity. You look at your phone, you got, how many bars you have, and you're like, I need a charge. Let me tell you, when you're at your weakest and you're solely and completely dependent upon God, that's when you got full bars there, fully charged, 100% in regards to your strength. He says, I have become a fool in boasting. You have compelled me, for I ought to have been commended by you. For in nothing was I behind the most eminent apostles, though I am nothing. So I shouldn't have to boast in what the Lord has done in my ministry. You guys, as a church, Paul says, you should be doing that to the Corinthians. You should be boasting in what the Lord has done in my ministry. He says, truly the signs of an apostle You want signs. Truly the signs of an apostle were accomplished among you with all perseverance in signs and wonders and mighty deeds. What signs and wonders is he talking about? Well, you know, we can speculate. Obviously, many miracles were done there. But the fact that there was a Christian church at all in the city of Corinth was a miracle in itself. I mean, you talk about a city, just historically, a city just full of debauchery and sexual immorality and idol worship and just as far from God as a culture could be. And all of a sudden, the fact that these Corinthians were turning away from idol worship, turning away from their sexual immorality, turning away from these lives filled with debauchery, they were turning away from wickedness and they were turning toward Christ. That was a miracle. And Paul says here, you know, all that happened through the message that Paul brought to Corinth. And it's affirmation of his apostleship. You know, they were doubting his ability to be able to discern and disseminate truth. And Paul's like, remember the last chapter? I'm the one that brought you truth in the first place. You would not even know who Jesus was if God hadn't sent me there to you. Now you're doubting my ability to share truth? I mean, nothing that was done in that church in Corinth, nothing good, came out of any of these false apostles, any of their words or deeds or whatever. Everything good came from the gospel message that Paul brought there. And he says, "For what is it in which you were inferior to other churches except that I myself was not burdensome to you?" In other words, the only difference between you and all the other churches that I have planted, Paul says, the only area where you guys were inferior, is they had never contributed monetarily to Paul's ministry. I never took any money from you, Paul says. And then sarcastically, he says, "Forgive me this wrong." Clark says in his commentary, "It is the privilege of the churches of Christ to support the ministry of his gospel among them. Those who do not contribute their part to the support of the gospel ministry either care nothing about it or derive no good from it." In verse 14, now for the third time, Paul says, "I am ready to come to you." Paul had already been to Corinth twice. First time he spent 18 months there planting that church, a year and a half ministering to the people there. Now he's set to go back a third time. And he says, "I will not be burdensome to you. I'm still not coming for your money. For I do not seek yours," I like this, "I do not seek yours, but you." I don't want your money and your possessions. What I want is you. What the Lord wants is you. A godly minister does not serve based on what he can get out of God's people. He serves based on what he can give God's people. Just as Jesus came, not based on what he could get from us, which is very little. He came based on what he could give us, which was infinite, eternal blessing. "For the children," he says, "ought not lay up for the parents, but the parents for the children." It's the, you know, the setting where you got little kids in the home. You got the family setting here. And who is it, you know, that brings the support? It's the parents, not the kids. You don't say to your 8-year-old, "Hey, listen, you know, I've been working long enough. You need to, you know, mow some yards or something. You got to pay the rent." You do that when they're 16, by the way. No. So, "I do not seek your money." Paul saw himself as the, you know, the figurative spiritual father of this church, the Corinthians. And, you know, he's like, I come to take care of you, not you take care of me. And you know, which was the opposite of these false apostles. If they truly were apostles, they wouldn't be looking to become rich by fleecing their so-called children. He says, "I will very gladly spend and be spent for your souls." Now, Paul's about to be spent. He's going to have his head chopped off for the sake of the gospel, right? And he says here, "I will very gladly do it for your sake." It says a lot about the character of Paul. And again, it confirms the fact that he is a true apostle. Though he says, "The more abundantly I love you, the less I am loved. You ever been in one of those kind of relationships where no matter how much you pour out love to someone, they just continue to reject you? The more Paul served them, the more they took it for granted. And so all Paul's saying there in that verse is, you know what, I'm just not feeling very appreciated right now. Which that can happen in ministry, right? But why do you serve? Do you serve to be appreciated by man, or rewards from man or God? Most people, they don't mind serving in church. They're just fine with serving. Nobody minds serving in a church until somebody makes them feel like a servant. I don't mind serving as long as you don't treat me like a servant. And Paul's like, I don't mind being a servant. And notice that it, you know, being unappreciated, it didn't matter. It didn't affect, you know, the fact that Paul would not only continue to serve them, but he would continue to serve them with gladness and with joy. As he said, I will very gladly spend and be spent for your souls. But be that as it may, I did not burden you. Nonetheless, being crafty, I caught you by cunning. You see that exclamation point there. And that's the accusation against Paul. That, you know, these false apostles are saying, oh, here's this Paul. He's this crafty guy, you know, and he's coming in. He's trying to trick you. And Paul's like, well, wait a minute. Have I taken anything from you? What am I trying to trick you out of? Except for hell or your sin? I haven't taken any money from you. I haven't taken anything from you. Nobody that I've sent. He says here in verse 17, did I take advantage of you by any of those whom I sent to you? Neither Paul or any of his proteges, or it was, you know, Timothy or Titus or whoever. Silas, no one in Paul's ministry had ever perpetrated, you know, any sort of financial impropriety in any church, let alone the church in Corinth, who had given nothing in the first place. He said, I urged Titus and sent our brother with him. Did Titus take advantage of you? Did we not walk in the same spirit? Did we not walk in the same steps? Again, do you think that we excuse ourselves to you? Now, what's he saying there? And I, you know, the whole point is you're accusing me and my ministry of financial impropriety. And first of all, you haven't given anything. But even if you had, what good would it do me to make excuses to you for my wrongdoing when ultimately I'm going to answer to a higher power? I'm going to answer to God. He said, we speak before God in Christ. And I can tell you right now, when every time I teach on a Sunday morning, I am well aware, if there's 82 people in this room right now, I know that God's sitting in the front row taking notes. I'm aware of that. And so it's God. We speak before God in Christ, but we do all things, beloved, for your edification, to build up the church. That's what church is for, to build up God's people, not tear them down, not to fleece them. Everything I do is for the purpose of building you up, Paul says. And now he's going to close out this chapter admonishing the Corinthian church for their lack of consecration. And it's very sad because, once again, it seems like they were not dealing with sin correctly. There was sin in the church, and they were sweeping it under the rug, so to speak. They were, once again, as you remember, you know, Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, this church was being heavily influenced by the world. The world was coming in. Instead of the word going out into the world, it was the world that was coming into the church. They were being influenced by the world. And Paul says, for I fear lest when I come, I shall not find you such as I wish, and that I shall be found by you such as you do not wish. And then here are the fruits of a worldly thinking church. If you have a church that's being infiltrated by the world and worldly ideologies, here's what you're going to get. Lest there be contentions, jealousies, outbursts of wrath, selfish ambitions, backbitings, whisperings, conceits, and tumults. So Paul, you know, he said, I don't want to come there and find your church in this kind of condition. And if he did, What he's saying here is that, listen, if you're not pleasing to me, meaning if you're not walking with the Lord, if you're not pleasing to me, then make no mistake, my presence there is not going to be pleasing to you. It's like my dad used to say, don't make me take my belt off. And that would usually do the job right there. If he ever said that, I don't remember him ever being challenged enough to have to make good on those words. Lest, verse 21, when I come again, my God will humble me among you, and I shall mourn for many who have sinned before and have not repented of the uncleanness. Notice. Then he uses the word fornication. He doesn't say adulterers. He says fornication, which includes anything of a sexual nature outside of marriage. And today, we have the rampant pornography use that this fornication. This word is just it's any sort of sexual activity outside of marriage, and it just God absolutely abhors it. God hates it. And then he says, and lewdness, which they have practiced. Now, what's Paul getting at? Nothing worse than a church full of prideful, unrepentant hypocrites. And if Paul comes and he finds this church in this condition, as a pastor, as a figurative spiritual father to this church, Paul says, if I come and I find your church in this sinful condition, it's going to cause me to greatly mourn. It's going to absolutely shatter my heart. It's going to bring great grief upon my life. But notice that as Paul illustrates the heart of God here and demonstrates the heart of God in relation to sin and hypocrisy, where Paul is more grieved, just as it is with God, what is more egregious than the sin itself? And we recognize that God is grieved over sin. We also recognize that we're all sinners and that we fall short sometimes. And eventually, at some point in time, all of us are going to fail. All of us are going to fall short. And even though that sin breaks the Lord's heart, what Paul, I think, is communicating here is what is more egregious than the sin itself is the unrepentant heart. It's the lack of brokenness. And brokenness, brokenness that leads to repentance. When you sin, yeah, you're sorry, but you just continue in it. Lack of brokenness. Unrepentant hearts. That's when God's heart is absolutely shattered. And we're going to stop right here and take communion, but I just want you to keep that in mind as we prepare hearts to come to the Lord's table. If I could get the ushers to come forth. Father God, we just pray that you would just fillet our hearts this morning, God, and that you would uncover any sort of unrighteousness in our hearts and lives, and God, that you would cause us to have hearts that desire holiness and desire your best and desire to bring you pleasure, Lord, and that we wouldn't be bound by sin, that we wouldn't be bound by immorality, Lord, but we would be bound by our love for you. I pray, Lord, that you would forgive us of all unrighteousness, God, and that you would make us worthy through the shed blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. You'd make us worthy to come to your table this morning. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Lord, we pray that you'd bless our week. Thank you for this year, 2020. Lord, may we each have a new resolve and a new energy and a new commitment to holiness, Lord, and just being about your business. Make this year a great year, Lord, in regards to making you famous in this land and sharing your word of truth in this lost and dying world. Use us, God, in strong and mighty ways. Bless our church, Lord, and our community. And we just pray, God, that this place would be a beacon of light shining forth your love and your truth. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. If you've never received the Lord, if you just need prayer, I'm available to pray with you after service. Don't forget about our women's Bible study. Men's Bible study starts back up tonight. Ignite Youth tonight as well here at 6 p.m. This Wednesday, our midweek study at 7 p.m. We'll be finishing up the book of Exodus, so chapters 37 through 40. Go ahead and read forward on that. And then next Sunday, we'll finish up the book of 2 Corinthians. So 2 Corinthians chapter 13. So read forward on that. Let's all stand and we'll close. I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice to worship you, O my soul, rejoice. Take joy, my King, in what you hear. May it be a sweet, sweet sound in your ear. I love you. God bless you. That's how you
change the world. Thank you for listening to Change the World with Pastor Vic Carroll from Calvary Somerville. It is our hope that this message will help you grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ.